And my clapper got stolen.
Your clapper got stolen?
Yes, so I'm going to have to ask you to do an acoustic clap, if you can. A multi-instrumentalist
clap.
If you could give me a clap. All right. So I'm with Troy from Nightwish. Hello.
Hello.
How's it going?
Nice to meet you. Good, good.
Nice to meet you.
Good, yes.
I'm really excited to chat to you.
Fantastic.
Because we can talk about all your instruments.
Ooh.
How many can you play?
I'm not sure. I'd have to think about it. I meddle and twiddle with things. To a reasonable degree of proficiency, I'd say, but maybe 5 or 6.
Okay.
That I can kind of make people believe that I know what I'm doing. But my main instruments, I think it's just, I spent a lot of my life I think the thing is with it is I always felt like I had to find the tools and the means to create and find a particular sound, even when I was a kid. And I had to just learn how to get that sound. Hence the uilleann pipes, which is a reasonably obscure instrument. Well, it was when I started playing them. It was just the sound that hit me really deeply. And I just knew I had to somehow learn how to play them, even though there was no means for me to do that at the time. All I had was an oral tradition, of listening to things. And same, out of necessity, I had to teach myself how to play keyboards and various woodwinds, because I needed to get that sound, within my sound world.
So you're self-taught with all the
instruments? Yeah, absolutely, yeah, totally self-taught, yeah.
Well, those annoying people.
Sorry. Yeah.
Okay, so what has been the most challenging to learn?
Oh, definitely the uilleann pipes by a mile, by 50 miles, 100 miles. Notoriously difficult instrument to learn, hideous thing to maintain. Difficult thing to keep in tune because it's not equal temperament, so it's really susceptible to temperature change. So if you're in, say, we were on tour in South America, and they really did not like the altitude of Colombia. So I got the pipes out to play in Colombia, and they just wouldn't play. It was just like, and I was like, what? And they just refused to play. And it was a nightmare. I mean, that's happened to me a lot of times. Singapore, it's too humid. They don't like that either. They're like a living organism, the uilleann pipes. But they are full of organic material. They're made out of the reeds are made out of Spanish cane, and so they don't like temperature changes. They don't like. They're real brats, really. They're a brat of an instrument.
Okay. So if it won't play, what do you do?
You've just got to dive onto another instrument and try and get around it. Like grab a flute or something, whatever you can get around. But yeah, a nightmarish thing. I mean, it was a real rod for my own back when I took up that confounded instrument.
Is that something you discovered, or did you know that?
No, at the time, as I said, I just needed to play them. I just really needed to get that sound, because it just felt really close to me. I just loved the sound so much. I had no idea what the instrument looked like.
Okay.
At all at the time. I saw the name of it and I thought, what could this be? But to me, it sounded like an animal singing.
Okay.
It sounded like some kind of living thing. I couldn't identify it with strings, like a stringed instrument, or even a woodwind instrument, or anything. It was like, what is that sound?
Yeah.
And I just fell in love with it. And then I embarked on the rocky and torturous road of trying to play the things.
So how long did that take?
Well, there's an old saying that a lot of old fellas over in Ireland say, is that to learn the pipes, you've got to spend 7 years listening, 7 years practicing, and 7 years playing before you can play the pipes. But that's an old wives' tale. I was so dedicated that I just spent all day learning to play them, and I had them pretty good after about a year.
Okay.
I was pretty up there with them, which was quite freakish, because there was nobody to teach me. I just had a book, some old antique book on how to play the pipes, but that was it. Just listen to lots, and but this applies to every instrument. You know, if you want to learn how to play the tuba, you can do it if you really, really want to. If you're really dedicated, you can do it. You know, you've got to commit yourself to it. Mm. You can't do it haphazardly or only half. Where
you have to be dedicated.
Yeah, passionate. You do. So that's what happened with that. But I was playing the guitar before the pipes, and then before the pipes, I was starting to play whistles and things like that. And it just, my armory of instruments just expanded from there. And then I thought, oh, well, I'll have a little twiddle with that. And then, oh, I'll have a go with that. Oh, do you know how to play it? Yeah, I'll have a go at it. Yeah, so it was like that. And here I am.
Do you find yourself collecting instruments just because it's an instrument?
No. I can see the attraction, but it's never appealed to me. You know, I know guys who've got like 30 electric guitars and, you know, collect guitars and stuff, but I've only got 29. I'm only joking. I've only got a few electric guitars. I've got two sets of pipes. But no, I'm not a collector.
It's a bad habit, don't start.
I think it is,
I play drums, and right. I can like play along to a song with bass. Right. That's about it. But I've got a ridiculous amount of guitars. I've got 20 at the minute.
Dear.
But I get them from car boots, so cheap.
Oh, well, that's not bad.
It's not like I'm investing a lot.
It's not like you're collecting Gibson Les Pauls from 1958 or something.
So yeah, I can see what you mean about the pipes like singing to you.
Oh yeah.
Because they do sound very kind of primal, almost, I think.
They do.
It's almost relaxing to hear it.
I totally agree. They do sound primal. I think that's why I kind of envisaged some kind of animal. Because when I was a kid, I mean, when I heard the pipes, I was really young, but they're such an evocative sound, and they're very eloquent sounding things, and they've got a really lyrical kind of, the way you can make them sing is very sweet and lyrical, unlike other bagpipes, which are just on and off, you know. But the uilleann pipes, they're really an over-evolved bagpipe, overdeveloped. Yeah. And that's their attraction, I think, is that they and they're not a gimmick. Unlike if you know, like when AC/DC stuck the Scottish pipes in, you know, it's a long way to, if you want rock and roll. It was kind of gimmicky. It was like, Scottish bagpipes. But with the uilleann pipes, they're more universal. The more they can fit into any genre as well, which is why I really wanted to take them into metal, which is where they belong. But I've always used them in rock bands and progressive rock and all kinds of stuff, because they fit, and they have the same expressive quality as a electric guitar as well. A friend of mine said, you play the pipes exactly the same way you play the electric guitar. And I thought that was the ultimate compliment.
Yeah.
You know, that it's the same expression, but just through a different tool, a different instrument, but it's the same thing that I want to get across, you know.
Yeah, I think they're a bit more subtle.
Oh yeah, yeah, they are. They are. They're a beautiful instrument.
So talking about how they don't like different temperature changes and stuff, do they change whilst on stage as well?
They do. I think there's plenty of footage of me in on YouTube in the middle of songs, taking the top off the pipes and then adjusting the reed and pulling it out and then trying to move the collar to try and, you know, flatten the reed or sharpen it. If it gets too hot, they sharpen in pitch. If it's too cold, they flatten in pitch. It's a nightmare. It doesn't happen with guitars, you know, you just tune it, but with the pipes you've got to take the whole thing to apart. So I'm sat on stage. There's, I think in one of the first shows I did with Nightwish was in about 2008 at the Astoria in London, when the Astoria existed. And it's on YouTube, and the band's firing away with this piece, The Last of the Wilds. The band's firing away, and I'm sat there trying to get the, you know, adjusting the reed, you know, and then putting the, you know, and it's like, come on. Then bang, and you're on. Yeah. Not easy, but it's worth it. You know, it's worth the pain and the struggle and the nightmarish terrible temperamentally wobbly instrument. but it's worth it in the end. Sounds like you could be a budding piper in you.
Well, I do like bagpipes.
Yeah, but the uilleann pipes are a different universe.
I think they're a better class, maybe.
Oh, different universe, different altogether. Never been a fan of the bagpipes, but again, I always knew what the bagpipes looked like. But when you hear the uilleann pipes, they're just different world, different universe.
Yeah. The bagpipes are a bit over the top, aren't they?
Yeah, they are, and they're foghorn loud as well. You can't play them indoors. Where with the uilleann pipes, they're a chamber instrument. You know, they were developed as a chamber instrument in the 18th century, and they grew from a really old English bagpipe called the pastoral pipes, and they're very similar in tone as well. But they developed throughout the British Isles over 200 years. With people adding innovations to it. They were a revolutionary instrument. So you've got one guy in Newcastle adding a key to it that would make something easier, and another guy in Dumfriesshire putting something onto the bag, and then you've got a guy over in Dublin making them jump the octave, and it's fascinating stuff. Okay. So it was a combined effort throughout the British Isles to build this thing. Yeah. And extraordinary thing.
Okay. So you say you taught yourself. Are you a teacher of it now?
No.
Okay.
No. I did one session up in Gateshead. There's like a folk music course up there, and I was asked by a friend to go up and do it, but it just wasn't for me, you know. And kids asking me advice on how to become a successful musician, it's really hard to deal with, you know. And you've got to tell the truth. Yeah. You know, you've got to tell the truth that it's not easy. You know, you've got to really be prepared to suffer. And struggle to be a professional musician. At any time in history, it's never been easy. Mm. But if you persevere, you'll eventually get there.
Okay. So if you're playing instruments already with a reed, does that help you, give you an advantage to learn it?
Maybe. I'm not sure. Again, it's the word dedication, really. You've got to really throw it. You've got to really give yourself to it, and then it gives back to you. You know, if you're really determined and besotted by the sound of something, whether that's a electric guitar, a trumpet, or the uilleann pipes, it doesn't matter. If you're besotted, it just you start to force your personality onto the thing, and it gives it back to you as well.
Right.
I think that might sound a bit airy fairy, but that's kind of the way it feels. It's a difficult thing to talk about, really.
Labour of love.
Yeah, absolutely. It is a labour of love. And I'm still, you know, I just got a brand new set of pipes made for me for the last tour. Yeah, brand new set. And it's a revolutionary set of pipes. Never seen the likes of them before. And I took them out on the last Nightwish tour around the world, and they were a lot more stable than the last one, because they're completely stainless steel. There's no wood in them, which is really rare. I mean, they're a revolutionary set. So I'm playing those, and all is looking good at the moment. But who knows? I'll probably get to first show in South America, and they'll go, and that'll be it again.
Are you the first person to have them?
Yeah. This particular type of set of uilleann pipes. Yeah, they were made kind of up to my specifications, but the guy who made them's a brilliant craftsman, and he was the apprentice to the guy who made my original set, who's now dead. So it's like a continuation of that brilliance into this new guy who's a lot younger.
Okay. Can't be many people making them.
Not making quality sets like that. There are, you can get Pakistani sets, but they don't work.
Oh.
They don't work at all. But you can't, unfortunately, I know a lot of kids who, through Nightwish, of where I really want to learn how to play that instrument, and they've got Pakistani sets that don't work.
Ah.
You know, they're just toys. You know, and I wish I could help them in some way.
Do a disclaimer in the booklet.
Yeah, that's a good idea. I might have to do that.
Speaking of which, I guess we should talk about Nightwish.
Yeah.
What number studio album is this for you?
It's my fourth. The first two was as a session player. So the first one was Dark Passion Play in 2007, when I first met the guys. here in London. And then it was Imaginarium, and I started to get more involved in Imaginarium, more involved in the musical aesthetic of yeah. certain pieces, and getting involved on the periphery of recording outrageous ideas to insert into songs and okay. all kinds of stuff, atmospherics and things like that, and ideas. So I started to get more involved then. Then me and Flo joined the band in, what year? 1968 or something. feels like a long time ago. But we, once we joined the band, we did the album Endless Forms Most Beautiful, and as members. And now here we are with the new one.
So how much input do you get?
Again, it's the Thomas writes the songs. Everybody gets involved in the arrangements. But me and Thomas are close friends, and we like the same stuff. You know, we talk about the same stuff. So me and him constantly talking about the future and how we can expand the palette of Nightwish, okay. and oh, what about this? Oh yeah, how about this? That's kind of the way we are. What about if we do this? What about that? And how about if we can get this? That's the running commentary of our world, Nightwish. So I get it. Again, I get involved a lot in conceptually and trying to facilitate crazy ideas. You know, like getting David Attenborough to read on the
okay.
final disc, stuff like that. We couldn't get him. But he did send us a lovely handwritten letter of rejection.
Okay.
Yeah, which was nice. But
that on your Instagram.
Yeah, well, but stuff like that. And like on Imaginarium, I recorded all the creepy kids that appeared in the songs, Scare Tale. I recorded those in my village, oh. the local school. Stuff like that. You know, I like to get involved in that kind of thing. But the fact of the matter is Thomas has always written the songs for Nightwish, and that's the way it should be. I'm reluctant to get involved in any of that. And I think everybody is, because it's like, I don't want to use the word formula because that sounds static, but Nightwish and the movement of it and the way it is, you know, Thomas kind of invented that, you know, back in 1997 or something. So all I like to do is try to help expand the world of Nightwish, expand it with lots of different colours and lots of different ideas that come from outside of the usual. That's what I like to do.
Okay. Is there a talks of a gig with an orchestra?
Well, that's kind of been on the cards for years, and it still is, and it will happen eventually, but not at the moment, because the logistics of doing it are just insane.
Obviously, at all wouldn't work.
Obviously not, but for some kind of showcase or event, then definitely. But we will do it eventually. It's like, you know, I was asked earlier about, was it unusual to do a full disc of orchestral music, because the second disc on the new album is an orchestral suite. And I said, well, no, it wasn't, because it was inevitable. You know, it's such a large component of the sound of Nightwish, the orchestra and choir, that it was inevitable that we would do an extended long orchestral piece, which is was long overdue, in my opinion. It's have you heard it?
No, I only heard the single.
Oh, really?
There was, I think it was 2 weeks ago, there was the listening party. I wasn't invited to that.
Really?
No. I don't live in London,
outrageous.
So
I
let them make you look faster.
That's even more outrageous. You should have been invited first.
Yeah, but I think Royal Albert Hall with an orchestra.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, that's the keystone, isn't it? Royal Albert Hall. Do it in there. And that's got such a heritage of rock bands with orchestras as well.
Exactly.
Going back to Deep Purple, I think.
Really?
Yeah, 1968 or something crazy.
An orchestra?
Yeah. They did an album, Deep Purple, with orchestra.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was an orchestral, I think it was a concerto written by John Lord, the keyboardist, but with the band. So there you go. Yeah.
Yeah, and this is the symphonic metal band. It's got to be done.
It does, and it will happen, but just not yet. Not yet.
In good time.
All in good time, yeah.
So on the tracks for the album, what have do you feel most proud of?
That's difficult. Pride. The thing that I'm most gratified by is the exploratory side of the new album. Okay. That it has moved outside of its usual zone that Nightwish is in. Even though Nightwish is always moving, it's always changing. I think this one is even more than the rest. It's moved into different areas that it's still quintessentially Nightwish, obviously it's got all the ingredients, but there are atmospheres in it that have really, really hit me. You know?
Okay, atmospheres.
Yeah, you've got to hear it. And there's a space in it as well that's missing from the last few albums, in that the first disc, which is all songs, is the human side of the album. So it's split into two discs. You've got human, nature, and the second disc is nature, which is the big orchestral suite. But that's only loose. I mean, it's fairly ambiguous as to what's going on there. And nature, humanity, they're the same thing. We are part of nature, but the separation is there. And that first disc of eight or nine songs, I think, we had a skeleton crew of orchestra. There was hardly anything. There was, I think, string quartet, string quintet, something like that, and a choir. So you've got this, it sounds really quite different. It's still orchestral, but it's really stripped down. And then you've got the full-blown symphony orchestra on the second disc. But it gives those songs a strange new feel, really. And I'm really pleased about that. And, of course, I'm... again, I don't know whether... Hello? Oh.
I think...
Yeah. I was the police coming to take it away. I can actually listen to it without myself in it. Last week I listened to it again with a nice glass of wine in front of our fire, and it was powerful stuff, completely objectively, and I wasn't in there. I've managed to disconnect myself to it and everybody in the band. So I'm not hearing Flo, I'm not hearing Marco or Thomas or Kaitsu or Empu. It's just music, and it's really, really impressive to me. I think it's the best Nightwish album by a million years.
Okay.
But I'm a bit biased. Yeah. But I'm trying not to be.
But if you think so, and you started on Dark Passion Play, that's my favourite album.
Dark Passion Play was great.
I'll take your advice. I'll listen out for those atmospheres.
Yeah, do it. But do it. Do it in the right environment. Make sure it's night time, it's after 9 o'clock, and you're in the dark with it.
Okay, candles?
Definitely candles.
Okay. Glass of wine.
Glass of wine, red candles. Red, definitely. A nice, rich Malbec, something like that. And make sure that the candles are scented.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you like scented?
Maybe the sea or some sea.
Sea.
But yeah, go in there and go in deep and come out the other side and see how you feel. And have a little break in the middle. So you do the first disc, have a little break for a cup of tea or another glass of wine, and dive into the second disc. And when you come out the other side, I defy you to have not at least lost half of your eyebrows.
Blown off or burnt off?
Blown off. Or burnt off. It sometimes burns people's eyebrows off as well. But yeah. Yeah, I think if you're a fan of Dark Passion Play, you'll get it.
So atmospheric, mind-blowing.
Yeah, I know. I'll probably get loads of terrible stuff on the...
What are you on about?
What are you talking about on social media? I'll be completely shut down, but that's how it makes me feel at the moment. But again, it's still pretty fresh. I mean, it's only been recently mastered and finished. We had a listen through in Lapland, which you should have been at.
I saw Marcus was there.
Yeah, he was. Yeah. Well, you know, you've got to sort yourself out, you. You've got to assert yourself.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you.
Is that it?
Yeah.
fantastic.
Said, yeah, thank you very much for talking.
Well, that was great. It was nice. That felt really nice and informal.
Mm.
You know.
I like that. Okay.
Go on. So back on. Hang on. I'll put the clapper back on. Right.
Thank you. What's your favourite cheesecake?
Well, you see, I'm vegan.
That's okay.
So I'm dairy free. But I must stress, I'm not one of the current new wave of fashionable, right on trendy vegans. I've been vegan for 37 years. Oh, wow. Back when it was impossible to eat anything other than grass. So, you can get some phenomenal vegan cheesecakes now from various supermarkets. I don't want to get myself into trouble by choosing one supermarket over the other. Because,
okay,
as you know, a lot of Nightwish fans work in certain supermarkets and they'll go crazy if they hear me pushing one over the other one. So, what about you? What's your favourite cheesecake?
New York cheesecake, but with chocolate chips.
I do like blackcurrant cheesecake with extra thick oaty bases.
Mm.
Yeah.
Oh, do you know what the best base I had was Lotus Biscoff.
Ooh.
Oh.
That sounds nice.
That's really good.
Don't tell me that again. Fancy a bit of that right now.
Next time we make one, Lotus Biscoff
okay.
base.
That sounds good to me. Brilliant.
All right, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Have another couple of days. You're doing tomorrow as well, aren't you?
We are. We've got a long one tomorrow.
All right, good luck.
We're doing a live acoustic session for Planet Rock tomorrow.
Oh, cool.
Awesome. Which will be good.
We'll have fun.
Yeah, brilliant. Okay.